Hello everyone, my name is Dr. Rakesh Gopinathannair. I'm a cardiac electrophysiologist at the Kansas City Heart Rhythm Institute and a professor of medicine at the University of Missouri-Columbia. Thank you for the opportunity to introduce the latest scientific statement from the American Heart Association on cardiac arrhythmias and autonomic dysfunction in COVID-19. I want to thank American Heart Association for commissioning this scientific statement. I had the distinct honor to be the chair of the writing group for this scientific statement. And I also want to thank the members of my writing group for their significant contributions to this document. So why was this document necessary? As we all know, we went through the COVID pandemic and we still have COVID, and it has moved from a pandemic state to an endemic state. Also, there are several questions regarding autonomic dysfunction and long COVID and patients suffering from that. And also, how do you manage arrhythmias in these patients even after COVID infection? So it was felt that it was a gap in knowledge and that clinicians need more direction regarding the state of the art in terms of what data is out there and how we can manage patients in this scenario where new strains are still being developed. We are still fighting COVID. On the other hand, there is also several questions about the impact of vaccines on arrhythmias and cardiac inflammation, which are questions that come up very often. That's the impetus for this scientific statement, where we review the available data, which includes randomized trials, observational studies, registry data, and all the meta-analysis that has looked at arrhythmic manifestations, long-term outcomes, autonomic dysfunction, and as well as sudden cardiac death and myocarditis and their impact on arrhythmias in the COVID-19 population. We also summarize the writing group's consensus on the implications for clinical practice, as well as we identify gaps in knowledge that requires future research in this manuscript. So now we'll take a little deeper dive into the manuscript. The first part of the manuscript actually discusses the pathophysiological mechanisms that underlie arrhythmic manifestations in patients with COVID-19. A lot of different mechanisms have been postulated, including direct viral entry, myocardial inflammation, critical illness-related release of cytokines, and overall the acuity of illness and patient factors among those. In fact, several of the specific mechanisms still remain elusive, and there's definitely a patient factor, there's definitely a direct COVID infection, and also the underlying acuity of illness all contribute to some of the arrhythmic manifestations. And we detail the available data on pathophysiological manifestations, and we also acknowledge that we still need to learn a lot about this. We then discuss various arrhythmic manifestations. We start with the Brady arrhythmias, and then we move on to one of the common manifestations that has happened, including atrial arrhythmias, especially atrial fibrillation and atrial flutter. One of the interesting studies was to look at whether how COVID-19 compared with the flu in terms of its impact on atrial fibrillation and survival. And this study showed that, in fact, the incidence of atrial fibrillation and flutter was pretty similar with COVID-19 compared to those in the flu season. And so it may not be a specific viral component, but it could be in general the catecholamine release as well as the acute illness factor associated with this disease. And we also outlined management of atrial fibrillation, including use of anticoagulation and also antiarrhythmic therapies, which also was initially during the pandemic was a big flashpoint in terms of QT prolongation and those drugs that were used. And so since we review the medical therapy for these conditions, these arrhythmias in the setting of COVID in this particular section. We then review ventricular arrhythmias and also sudden cardiac death. So an important aspect in the early part of the pandemic was that there was a substantial increase in out-of-hospital cardiac arrest. That's prime. Part of it was due to patients who were not seeking care, and also because of the issues with social distancing and contagious nature of the disease. This resulted in excess cardiovascular deaths, and we also look at in-hospital cardiac arrest and what the outcomes of those patients were. And if you think about it, there was also the early pandemic from China. There was significant concerns regarding ventricular arrhythmias and sudden cardiac death. And any person with a ventricular arrhythmia during COVID infection was considered to be at a high risk of sudden cardiac death. Whether it was directly due to COVID or due to the acuity of the illness, it's still a matter of debate. And so we also look at excess cardiovascular deaths across the spectrum, worldwide in the pandemic era. And we also discuss that what happened in follow-up. So one of the issues that we are seeing currently is that, okay, people are not getting that sick anymore with COVID, but however, they still get infection and they can have arrhythmic manifestations or autonomic manifestations following them. And so there have been studies that looked at how these patients who are recovered from COVID fared over a period of a year. And if there was, what we noted was, if a patient with cardiac arrhythmia during an acute infection with COVID, when they are followed up long term, they still have a higher risk of arrhythmic manifestations, especially atrial arrhythmia, premature ventricular beats, ventricular arrhythmias. And the message that we get from this is that we need to continue to follow these patients, and surveillance is important because the odds of recurrence of arrhythmias in these patients remains quite high. One of the most intriguing and puzzling aspects of COVID-19 have been the long-term effects associated with the illness, even after acute recovery. It has been called various names, and including long COVID or post-COVID syndrome, or post-acute sequelae of COVID-19, or PASC, P-A-S-C. One of the main sections of the scientific statement is devoted to autonomic dysfunction. So what is autonomic dysfunction? It's alteration of autonomic system parameters in patients who have had COVID infection, and they typically tend to show up weeks to months after the infection, usually several weeks after. And what kind of manifestations that do patients usually have? They usually develop fatigue, shortness of breath, overall feeling poorly. They also have significant symptoms such as, dizziness, sometimes, near passing out spells. A lot of studies have explored this, including the NIH commissioned RECOVER registry. And I would say that upfront that we are still in the process of having a deep understanding of this problem. And it can manifest in several ways. One particular presentation is what we call as postural orthostatic tachycardia. They stand up and then with a sudden increase in heart rate. Another manifestation would be what we call as orthostatic hypotension, where you have a substantial blood pressure drop with standing. And there is also patients with inappropriate sinus tachycardia. There are also patients where you get significant symptoms of dizziness. Their blood pressure remain same, and they don't have a whole lot of blood pressure drop or significant tachycardia. These myriad presentations are associated with them, and there is substantial fatigue, and all these symptoms together create poor quality of life for the patient, and sometimes it can be debilitating. We explored the pathophysiologic mechanisms, which unfortunately are not fully understood. Several theories have been postulated, including autoimmune phenomena, cytokine release from acute infection, and also deconditioning has been postulated as a cause, but it has been debated as deconditioning could be from acute infection. We don't have clear answers on what causes it in a specific patient or who is more prone to develop these. In terms of management, these patients require close follow-up and treatment strategies that are guided by the current autonomic disorder guidelines. We review the literature on this particular topic in very in great detail, and we also propose our writing group's consensus on how best to manage this patient. So I encourage you all to review this section very carefully, and I hope that you'll find that useful in treating your patients with COVID-associated autonomic dysfunction. We also have a section that explains the drug interactions between COVID-related medications used to treat COVID-19, which in the current era is primarily Paxlovid for acute infections. It's a combination of ritonavir and nirmatavir, and then there are several potential interactions with Paxlovid and drugs like antibiotics, especially macrolides, anticoagulants, and also antiarrhythmic drugs, especially for patients with other arrhythmias taking antiarrhythmic drugs. We have dedicated a table 3, which is in the manuscript, to detail all these drug interactions, which I think practitioners hopefully will find useful when you're using Paxlovid. One of the important sections in the manuscript deals with vaccine-induced arrhythmias, and this has been a hot topic with a lot of controversy. We review the available studies that evaluated this, and we also provide a summary of our writing group's consensus on this. I encourage you to review this section, as this comes up very often in clinical practice, especially with the newer variants coming and new vaccines being developed. And so I think hopefully this can answer some of the questions you may have in this arena. And to wrap up, I would like to focus your attention on Table 4 and Table 5, which the Table 4 actually summarizes the writing group's consensus on the considerations or implications of clinical practice based on the data from this scientific statement. And this goes over salient points that are clinically relevant based on each section in the manuscript. And Table 5 is also very important, is that we identify several gaps in knowledge that is currently have no good answers, and where future research would be really necessary to, identify either it be pathophysiological mechanisms, clinical manifestations and treatment strategies, as we continue to live in a time where COVID has transitioned from pandemic to endemic, but new strains are still coming through and we are still in a fight with COVID. With that, I would like to thank you all, and want to thank my writing group colleagues whose immense contributions to this scientific statement I must acknowledge, and also thank you again to the American Heart Association for identifying this as an important topic and commissioning this paper.